हाँ ऑडियो आ जाएगी ना ऑटोमेटिक। ये स्क्रीन शेयर है क्या?
सर
स्क्रीन जा रहा है
जी
अभी।
सर
बजे से शेड्यूल।
सर
हाँ हाँ स्टार्ट कर देते हैं, मतलब एक बार कन्फर्म करें, मुझे लिंक भेजना था।
ठीक है सर
नया लिंक तो नहीं खुलेगा ना?
नहीं सर यही लिंक
यही यही लिंक होगा।
रहेगा सर
मैंने भेज दिया सबको मेल किया होगा ना।
आपको फिर से म्यूट कर लीजिए सर
हाँ नहीं तो वो एको आएगा ना।
सर क्वेश्चन आंसर सर लास्ट में सर चैट में क्वेश्चन आंसर के लिए सर लास्ट में चैट में सर
ओके हाँ
सर
मतलब आंसर
ब्राउज
करना।
ब्राउजर में सर
हाँ ठीक है।
सर ब्राउजर में सर सर इधर सर
अच्छा, इसमें। ओके ओके थैंक यू। Good afternoon, everyone. Myself, Dr. Adil Mohammed. Today, my seminar is on recurrent respiratory papillomatosis. So, the outline of my presentation it includes history, introduction, etiology, pathogenesis, epidemiology, prevention, the clinics, management, and what's new, and bibliography. History. In late 1800s, Sir Moral Mackenzie recognized papillomas as a lesion of the laryngopharyngeal system in children. In 1923, Ullmann demonstrated its infective etiology by injecting homogenized papilloma from child's larynx into his own forearm. In 1940s, Chevalier Jackson coined the term juvenile laryngeal papillomatosis. In 1964, Jomchowski et al. Found virus particles in nuclei of cells of laryngeal papilloma biopsy specimen. In the early 1990s, identification of HPV in laryngeal papilloma lesions came. Recurrent respiratory papillomatosis is a potentially life-threatening disease characterized by development of papillomata anywhere in respiratory system from nasal vestibule to the terminal bronchiole. It is a most common benign neoplasm of larynx in children. It is the second most common cause of childhood hoarseness. It's a very economically and emotionally challenging disease. Children who are diagnosed at less than 3 years have a 3.6 times higher risk of having more than 4 surgeries per year. There are two variants, juvenile variant and an adult variant. Juvenile variant is an aggressive one and adult is a less aggressive one. Reports of RRP has come from neonate who is 1 day old till elderly people who are 84 years old. The juvenile onset peak occurs at around 3 to 4 years, and the boys to girls ratio is 1:1. The adult onset peaks at 20 to 30 years, and in that the male to female ratio is 3:2. Approximately 33% are extra laryngeal, 25% tracheal, and 10% bronchopulmonary. There is high suspicion of malignant degeneration in bronchopulmonary lesions. The etiology. So as I told in late 1990s, human papilloma virus was found to be the causative agent. It's an icosahedral capsid DNA virus from papilloma virus family. The size 52 to 55 nanometer. There's a single double strand DNA molecule with approximately around 8,000 base pairs bound to the histones. There is a protein capsid with capsomeres. There are more than 200 types of HPV identified. These are same sequence of genes, but they differ slightly in the nucleotide and the number in the beginning of the genes. The HPV 6 and 11, which cause the recurrent respiratory papillomatosis and the genital warts, and HPV 16 and 18, which cause the carcinoma, cervix, and head and neck, mostly oropharynx. Are important to us. So the HPV genome. This HPV genome is categorized into three main domains. First is the upstream regulatory region or the long control region, which is the non-coding part, and the coding part, which is early E region and the late L region. The upstream regulatory region have the binding sites for positively or negatively regulating transcriptional activators. There are 6 early proteins which are coded by the E part, and two late proteins which make up the viral capsid protein structure. So here you can see the HPV genome organization, the E1, E2, E4, E5, E6, E7. These are the early genes. The E designation refers to the genes that are transcribed early and are responsible for the replication of the viral genome, and L1, L2, they are the they are transcribed late in the viral cycle, and it forms the spiral capsid. Okay, so next is the pathogenesis. They enter the traumatized epithelium and they reside in the HPV reside in basal layer stem cells of the mucosa, and they replicate by episomal maintenance by the extra chromosomal DNA, which replicates autonomously. The replication interferes cell maturation, causing epithelial proliferation and neovascularization. This delayed maturation of the epithelium results in significantly thickened basal layer and nucleated cells in the superficial layer. So in the transmission, the main mode of transmission is vertical transmission. The minor to a lesser extent it can get transmitted through sexual abuse in utero and transplacental ways and direct contact. The firstborn child who is vaginal delivered, and if the mother had a long secondary stage of labor, then these are the high risk factors which expose the child to leading to a cause of this disease. Overt maternal condylomas are seen in greater than 50% of mothers who give birth to children with recurrent respiratory papillomatosis. Elective cesarean section as a means of recurrent respiratory papillomatosis prevention is still not recommended. So why? Because only a small portion of children exposed to genital condylomas at birth actually develop recurrent respiratory papillomatosis. Although HPV could be recovered from 30% of infants exposed to HPV, a small fraction only manifested the disease. The risk of developing a child developing a disease is 1 in 231 to 400. And there is also a huge population having subclinical mothers who are having subclinical HPV, and there are other high risk factors also. So for example, the role of immune response. Humoral or cellular immune response may be compromised in patients with recurrent respiratory papillomatosis. There can be malfunction of cell mediated response associated with the cytokines and MHC antigens. Certain papillomas have a stealth-like effect on immune surveillance due to reduced antigen expression. HPV infection can be actively expressed or latent. It can remain clinically or histologically normal, but still HPV infection will be there. HPV, because HPV DNA was detected in normal mucosa of RRP patients in remission period. And reactivation can occur at any time. So and the role of PD-1 and PD-L1, which I explained the few last slides. So the histopathology. This is a gross picture of a papilloma which was excised in our department, which was a complete excision. Microscopic papillomas will be seen have a velvety appearance, and the macroscopic papillomas will have a cauliflower or a grape-like projections. It can be sessile or pedunculated. This shows the histopathological. You can see a histopathological slide of a papilloma. It has multiple fronds or finger-like projections with a central fibrovascular core, and it's covered by a stratified squamous epithelium. And about prevention or vaccination. HPV type specific virus like particles from the major capsid L1, these are used to produce the vaccine along with even it is combined to an aluminium phosphate adjuvant. The vaccine has been used for prevention of cervical cancer, adenocarcinoma in situ, cervical intraepithelial neoplasia grade 1 to grade 3, vulvar and vaginal intraepithelial neoplasia grade 2 to 3, genital warts associated with HPV 6, 11, 16 and 18. This VLP, virus-like particle vaccine, contain repetitive high density displays of viral surface proteins. It present conformational viral epitopes, which elicit strong T cell and B cell immune responses. They lack genetic material, so they provide a safer alternative to attenuated viruses. So HPV, there are mainly three types, the cervarix, Gardasil, and the Gardasil 9. Cervarix is a bivalent, Gardasil is a quadrivalent, and Gardasil 9 has 9 types in that. The HPV include, I'll talk about cervarix first. It contains the HPV type 16 and 18, mainly for the cervical cancer, it's for cervical cancer. Dosing schedule is 1-6-1-0-1-6. And contraindication is hypersensitivity to latex. Manufacturers, GSK. Gardasil are the ones which are used for END purpose. Its dosing schedule is 0 to 6 months, and hypersensitivity to yeast is the contraindication, and manufacturer is Merck. There are this mainly the purpose of vaccination is for prevention, but there are still reports which show there was a report which showing 2-year-old child with RRP who was treated with a 9-valent HPV vaccine and subsequently experienced an increase in average intersurgical interval from 46 to 340 days, which means that it can have a therapeutic intent also. So ideally young boys boys and children before sexually active has to be are the ideal candidates for vaccination. Australia was the first nation who had a nationwide vaccination program. Statistically significant decrease in prevalence of HPV, all four types, in cervical samples comparing the pre and post vaccination period was found in among those population. There was clinical as well as immunological response, but the limitations are the cost availability, moral objection, vaccination, it may promote unprotected sexual activity and may lead to acquisition of other HPVs. There was a in Australia there was a decline in RRP annual incidence of 0.16 to 0.02 in 1 lakh children, with only 15 incident cases noted in the whole nation, and none of the mothers of these 15 children were vaccinated. So this is an article which came in BMC, and from this study they analyzed the use of 22-year retrospective analysis of vaccine. And it was concluded that our clinic, it's from the article only, that our clinical results after adjuvant immunization of 13 patients show a positive effect on the course of RRP. After vaccination, the recurrence rate appears to be significantly lower compared to the international literature. For this reason, the authors believe that HPV vaccination in RRP has a beneficial therapeutic effect by preventing the formation of new papillomas, and immunization may prevent the spread of the infection. And you can see the graph, which is a Kaplan-Meier graph, which is showing patient population and time to recurrence. And you can see the vaccinated have a higher time to recurrence. So in the clinics, what are the clinical features? The main clinical features are the voice change, stridor, and respiratory distress. So any child or any adult who comes with a voice, like mainly children, voice change, stridor, and respiratory distress, RRP has to be considered in the differential diagnosis. Voice change can be hoarse or weak voice since birth, unnoticed in it can go unnoticed in very young children. It can be aphonia, high pitched and breathy voice in lesions which are confined to glottis, and it can be low pitch, coarse or fluttery voice which are seen in subglottic lesions. And stridor, to start with, it will be inspiratory, and it can with progression it can go into biphasic stridor. Other clinical features can be chronic cough, And if there is pulmonary involvement, recurrent pneumonia, recurrent bronchitis, and failure to thrive. In cases which those children who don't present with a respiratory distress, then a detailed history has to be taken, which includes the time of onset, history of any trauma, history of any intubation, characteristic of the cry, feeding difficulties, congenital anomalies, voice abuse, history of any voice abuse, maternal or paternal history of any condylomas and allergic symptoms. So through this we can rule out any other pathological cause of this voice change, maybe and stridor, maybe vocal fold nodules, laryngeal malacia, paralysis of the vocal fold, subglottic cyst or subglottic hemangioma. So, as I said, extralaryngeal spread is seen in approximately 30% of children, and approximately 16% of adults are also present with extralaryngeal symptoms. So the most common extralaryngeal site is the oral cavity, and then comes the trachea, and then comes the bronchi. This is a picture which is showing a papilloma seen in the uvula, and it can be seen in trachea. You can see the peak over there. And in pulmonary papilloma, this lesion begin as an asymptomatic like peripheral nodule, which later forms central cavitation and central liquefactive necrosis. So it later leads into the destruction of the lung parenchyma, and there is a high risk of malignant transformation. So this is a CT which is showing central cavitation. So this is an article which was published from our department by Dr. Devraj and Dr. Kapil Sika in Southwest Journal of Pulmonary Critical Care. This you can see the chest red. This patient was taken taken into OT for debridement under ventriculostomy, and later the chest X-ray was done, and it was like you can see the picture in the chest radiograph, and for that CT was done, and you can see the CT film which is shown here. Multiple cavitary lesions are seen over here. And next, in examination, airway endoscopy. Detailed endoscopy evaluation has to be done for the nasal cavity, the pharynx, larynx, subglottis, and in the larynx, vocal cord, as we have to assess the lumen size, cord mobility, lumen size and cord mobility. In some cases, in children who are very much uncooperative, they might need endoscopy in the operating room under anesthesia. Nowadays, 1.8 mm distal chip endoscopes are available. Through using this, we can do endoscopy even in children, like the children in units. So then comes there is a staging by Derke et al. In this, there are 15 sites. Like Derke proposed. Staging in which multiple sites, this is a performa which included multiple sites, and we have to like examine and document it. And where if there is no lesion in like each of the site, in each site, if there are no lesions, then we will score it as zero. And if it is a surface lesion, we score it as a one, and raised lesion is scored as two, and a bulky lesion is scored as three. And this is from an article which was published by Derke CS and David J. Mellis. And you can see the larynx, there are 10 sites, trachea, there are 5 sites, and other parts like nose, palate, pharynx, esophagus, and lungs. These include, in total, it is 15 sites which are examined. This is a pictorial representation of the endoscopic image which we document. So then comes the management principles. First of all, we have to as these patients can be chronic patients, and as I mentioned, it can have a big emotional and economical impact on the family. So we have to convey the up-to-date literature regarding HPV to these patients or the caregivers. Especially, it's because the major chunk of the patients are children, and it should be done in a careful and sensitive manner. As of now, there is no current definitive cure for this disease, and there is no single modality of treatment. So our mainstay of management is focused to reduce the airway tumor burden and increase the time interval between procedures, and to optimize the quality. In lesions which involve the anterior commissure and posterior commissure, we have to do a staged papilloma removal. And our other focus is to prevent the complication of subglottic or glottic stenosis or web formation. So coming to the treatment, it can be cold steel surgery, using a microdebrider, laser therapy or coblation. These all come under the surgical part, and the medical part comes under, it's mainly adjuvant therapy. There is no single drug which is yet proven to be proven as a salt treatment for recurrent respiratory papillomatosis. So for this, as adjuvants, we can use antivirals, which include the interferon alpha, cidofovir, acyclovir, ribavirin, photodynamic therapy, indole-3-carbinol, anti-reflex therapy, methotrexate vaccine, especially HPV vaccine and mumps vaccine. So the surgical methods. First of all, I'll talk about CO2 laser. It was the mainstay of surgical management, and carbon dioxide laser, it converts the light energy to thermal energy, and this energy is absorbed, and this energy is absorbed by the intracellular water, and the vaporization happens. The merits are it gives a precise ablation with minimal bleeding, and it's very easy to use with a microscope and a micro manipulator. So you can see the image of a CO2 laser which is used in our department. So the demerits. The demerits of carbon dioxide laser is more late soft tissue complication. You can see an image of a patient who was underwent multiple surgeries with carbon dioxide laser, and later came with recurrence, and then on endoscopy you can see the anterior glottic web, you can see in the image, and during surgery the generation of laser plumes, they can be a source of infection. There can be injury to uninvolved tissues, which increase the risk of implantation of HPV virus and development of disease. There is a high risk of a laser burn, which can be handled to an extent with proper anesthesia techniques. Earlier, there was a thought that CO2 laser can be fiber delivered, but this is an image of laser burn. Nowadays, CO2 laser can be delivered using fiber, and this is a new latest ones which are coming from the Luminous company, and you can see the fiber delivered. There are two, like the micro manipulator one with this angled camera, the fiber delivered laser probe, you can see in the image. So the KTP in potassium titanyl phosphate, NDIAC and pulse dye laser, it is as effective as CO2 carbon dioxide laser in ablation and hemostasis. This KTP and NDIAC, they have direct vaporization of tissue. The KTP, it works, it has a frequency of 532 nanometer, and at this wavelength the oxyhemoglobin absorbs the energy. The pulse dye laser, it has 585 nanometer wavelength, and it has an oxyhemoglobin, so
with oxyhemoglobin, like it results in a, it's a vascularization, so it results in a photoangiolysis of sublesional microcirculation. It results in the denaturation of epithelial basement membrane, linking proteins, and cellular destruction. So it can be used as an adjunct to surgery. So the merits are minimal voice change. Previously, it was even though this the CO2 laser, the fiber delivery thing is very new one, but this KTP NTR pulse delay laser, they are delivered through optical fiber since a long time, and tracheal and bronchial papillomas can be removed using this. In adults, it can be done as a outpatient procedure as bronchoscopy. Along with bronchoscope, it can be used to remove to apply this laser coagulation. And the demerits, this as I told the pulse dye laser is a photoangiolytic laser, so it is less effective against the exophytic lesions. So then comes the cold steel surgery, which is the primitive use of microlaryngeal instruments. The use of microfab technique, it minimizes the trauma. There is no the advantages, there is no tremor damage, and there is the disadvantages, there is no direct hemostasis, which is seen in other methods. So even though it's a like a previous one, old one, those surgeons who are very good in doing this microflap technique and all, these lesions still these surgeries are still performed with a greater success. So these are the instruments which we use for microlaryngeal surgery. You can see the viewing ends, from the viewing ends, the Jackson, Hollinger, Zittels, Boucher, and the distal line. You can see here Jackson of the same in the other way around. These are dissection spatulas which we use, scissors which we use, alligator forceps, micro ring forceps, and cup forceps. So this is a microflap technique. We take a layer of the epithelium and removing the disease from the beneath layer, and we like micro suture it back. So you can see the outcome here. This is a depiction of the image. So then comes the micro debrider. So powered micro debrider is a new development, which is now be, it has become now a gold standard for the recurrent respiratory papillomatosis removal. Non-serrated laryngeal blade with a setting of 300 to 700 rotations per minute, they are used. The advantage are that there is no trauma, there is minimal damage to the surrounding normal tissues, less post-operative pain, minimal contamination of the lower respiratory tract with blood or papilloma, and less operating time is required. There is minimal delayed soft tissue complications also associated with microdebrider. So this has become a gold standard for papilloma removal nowadays. So you can see, as I told earlier, we have to use a non-serrated one. This is a microdebrider image. These are the images of blade tips, and mostly we use the skimmer blade for recurrent respiratory papilloma lesions. You can see a papilloma, like it's an illustrative image of papilloma removal using the skimmer blade. And this is a tri-cut blade, which is used for a bronchial, like closer to the carina lesion, which is closer to the carina. And which this is used in tracheobronchial disease lesions, and the skimmer blade is used in a mainly for the vocal fold. This is designed for that. And next is the coablation technology. This is a like it's an upcoming one, minimally invasive low heat technology. It delivers a plasma layer to dissolute target tissue while maintaining the integrity of the surrounding tissue. It works in a range of 40 to 70 degrees Celsius, and there is less charring or burning of tissues. And for recurrent respiratory papillomatosis, there is limited data available. This is a laryngeal coablator band which is used, and this is the tip of the band. You can see there are electrodes. This is the active one, this is the inactive one. Current flows from the here to here, and saline comes out from here, and the plasma is created in between this, and suction is working along with that. So there will be ablation of the tissue, and tissues will be sucked in inside this, through this, and that's how this work. And there are literatures coming up. There was a study which showing 6 patients, out of which they are showing a very good outcome. That means the intersurgical interval has multiplied 3 times. And there was another report which was showing 15, which had 15 patients, which was a 15 patient study, which also showing promising outcomes. So this is now it's a limited data available. So this is an upcoming thing. So then, next, coming to the anesthesia techniques, as I told, laser technology, for especially for laryngeal surgeries, airway surgeries, it's a big headache to the anesthesia team. There are mainly 4 techniques which we use. First is the spontaneous ventilation. In this, intravenous agents along with oxygen and sevoflurane are passed through the, they are entering through the side port of the laryngoscope. Patients on respiratory efforts are responsible for maintenance of the anesthesia, and this requires an experienced anesthetist. There can be laryngospasm, awakening, and other movements which can have a very disastrous outcome. Intermittent apnea reintubation. In this, the patient is intubated, anesthetized and intubated, and the suspension laryngoscope and all are kept, and we are examining the patient, we are operating, and when prior to the operation, the tube is withdrawn, and when the laser or micro defibrillator is used, then the tube is replaced back when oxygen of the patient, after seeing the monitors, when they find that the oxygen is diminishing, they will carbon dioxide accumulate, they will re-intubate the patient. The disadvantage is the potential of virus spreading. So it requires a frequent intubation, re-extubation. So in this, the potential of virus spreading through the repeated placement of tube is a disadvantage. The next is the wrapped or laser safe endotracheal tubes. These are laser safe from accidental ignition. The tube remains in the surgical field, potentially obscuring the subglottis and posterior glottis. Cuffs are to be protected with moist surgical cottonoids to prevent rupture, and to be inflated with saline. Better to be inflated with a methylene blue saline. Even if it ruptures, we can see through the identify through the color. So these are laser safe. These are metallic tubes which are used previously. Ideally, and it can be coated also. You can see how big this is. And these are ideally to be wrapped with aluminium foil or copper foil, or coated with a dental acrylic to prevent laser injuries. But the issue with the previous metallic one is there are no cuff available. You can see there are no cuff protection, and the thickness or the reflection by the metals can cause damage to the mucosa. So the laser can hit this metallic part and injure the other mucosa. Nowadays there are no laser safe tubes. You can see the MTL one is the Maligdrot laser tube, ML2 is the Medtronic laser tube, and the Rush laser tube which is RL. You can see the image. So the next technique is the jet ventilation. In this, high frequency gas source via a narrow cannula is attached to the suspension laryngoscope or bronchoscope, and the gas delivered at 10 to 20 breaths per minute, which is hand operated. Stream of a high velocity gas entrains the air, increasing tidal volume generated and diminishing oxygen concentration. So you can see the suspension laryngoscope and the tubing. You can see this is connected. Okay, this is more clear. You can see the side through the side port. We can put the jet cannula. And you can see this side, it comes in the around 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock position, and or sometimes it will be in the 12 o'clock position. This is a jet connected to a laryngoscope blade. You can see the jet cannula is connected to it. So the main advantage is it avoids the risk of airway fire. Operative field remains immobile for short period, and there is a good visualization of the vocal cord. But there are disadvantages. There is a high risk of transmission of HPV particles distally, risk of disseminating papilloma or blood into the tracheobronchial tree, and there are reports of there is high risk of pneumothorax with jet ventilation technique. And during jet ventilation technique, it is difficult to assess the adequacy of the anesthesia. So it may be needed to combine with total intravenous anesthesia. And gastric insufflation, if the laryngoscope is not aligned in a proper way, it can result in gastric insufflation. So then coming to the medical or the adjuvant therapy, first of all, I'll talk about antivirals, the interferon. Interferons are a class of protein manufactured by the cells in response to viral stimuli. It causes increased production of protein kinase, endonuclease, which block the viral replication and protein synthesis. They can alter the cell membrane susceptibility to viral penetration. The pegylated interferon alpha-2A, Pegasys, it's a better one compared to the interferon, which is because of its longer duration of action and once in a weekly subcutaneous injection mode of administration. And there was a long follow-up of patient for about 172 month follow-up, in which showed like 42% having a complete remission. And these interferons are more effective in HPV6 compared to the, which is 68% compared to the HPV11, which is 18%. There was a multi-center non-randomized prospective series which showed 63% having active diseases and patients with active disease and a surgery-free interval of less than 3 months had macroscopic remission in the end of the long-term follow-up. So then comes the antiviral sidofovir. So sidofovir, it is a nucleotide. Sorry, I didn't mention the adverse effect. Adverse effect are like fever, flu-like symptoms, nausea, vomiting, derangement of the liver enzymes, leukopenia, rashes, dry skin, alopecia. These are side effects which are related to antivirals. So then comes the sidofovir. Sidofovir is a nucleotide analog of deoxycytidine monophosphate, which inhibit the viral DNA polymerase. It is the most frequently used adjuvant drug. The intralesional injection is the preferred way. The multiple studies have shown disease remission in both adults and children, with none of them having a disease worsening. Documented regression of lung RRP lesion is in response to systemic sidofovir is also reported. No increased risk of dysplasia is found. There was in between reports that there is a chance of higher chance of dysplasia in patients who are treated with sidofovir, but based on a published literature, it can be concluded that dysplasia occurred in only 2.7% of 2.3% of children who had underwent a sidofovir intralesional injection, which is compared to the spontaneous malignant degeneration of around 2.7%. So these are indicated in patients who require greater than 6 surgeries per year and extralaryngeal spread and extralaryngeal, those have extralaryngeal spread. So as I mentioned, the action is mainly inhibiting the DNA replication, it enters the cell and inhibits the replicating cycle. The dosage which advised is less than 40 milligram per kilogram in adults and less than 3 milligram per kilogram in children. A total of 5 injections at 2 to 6 weeks interval is advised. So antivirals, ribavirin and acyclovir. Ribavirin is a synthetic nucleoside. It's a broad spectrum antiviral agent. As an aerosol, it is used in respiratory syncytial virus, and systemically it is used for hepatitis C treatment. 5 patients demonstrating complete remission at 4 months follow-up was found in a study, and it is not widely used because of the that's how we don't have much literature in with the use of ribavirin in relation to recurrent respiratory papillomatosis. Acyclovir, it's a nucleoside analog. It inhibits the thymidine kinase, which is seen in HSV. Adult patients, molecular evidence of co-infection with other viruses are also seen, like HSV. So, if there is any synergistic effect, this acyclovir can help to remove that synergistic effect. The adverse effects, you know, nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, fatigue, headache. Anti-reflex therapy, recurrent or chronic exposure to acid and gastric enzyme, it can cause the inflammation of the airway, like pharynx, larynx. Studies have shown when reflex therapies, like those patients who had a remission, and when they are kept on long-standing anti-reflex measures for a long period, when they don't follow, they don't have any, they have a poor compliance, papillomas return in some patients. It's a, as we know, it's a histamine receptor 2 type 2 antagonist, and it's useful in cutaneous warts, conjunctival papilloma. It has got an immunomodulatory action at very high doses. So a 40 milligram per kilogram for 4 months is the dose which we use. So along with surgical therapy, almost throughout the world, patients are kept in long-term anti-reflex regimen. Next is indole-3-carbinol. It was a nutritional supplement which was abundantly found in cruciferous vegetables, and it's a potent inducer of cytochrome P450 regulated estrogen metabolism. Estrogen is thought to be estrogen is increases the gene expression of HPV and epithelial cell proliferation. In a long-term prospective study, it showed that there was complete or partial response in 70%, approximately 30 patients having 30% of patients having complete response, and approximately 33 to 36% patients having partial response. And the adults responded better, and 30 patients of patients had no response. So it was once used. And next is bevacizumab. It is a very upcoming drug, bevacizumab, or also known as Avastin. It was developed using recombinant monoclonal. It's a recombinant monoclonal antibody which inhibits VEGF, vascular endothelial growth factor A. It was used in wide range. It's used in a wide range of metastatic cancers as immunotherapy. Metastatic cancers, both systemic and intralesional administration has been like trials have been done in both systemic and intralesional. It can be used in conjunction with sidofovir or KTP laser. It can reduce the number of procedures per year, and there is improved voice quality also noted with bevacizumab. The adverse effects are delayed wound healing, kidney failure, hypertension, and thromboembolism. The dose which we use 2.5 milligram per ml, 3 consecutive injection, 2 to 3 weeks at a 2 to 3 week interval. So it has shown a significant promise in patients, especially who have pulmonary disease. And it's mainly, the trials have been done mainly on patients who are poorly controlled with surgery and other adjuvant treatments. So these are two reports, like it's exactly opposite reports. First is a case report of a child, of an infant, as a 7-month-old infant who had a temporary improvement and eventual worsening after this bevacizumab treatment, and it has got increased the number of lesions. And in the second report, which is the systemic bevacizumab for end-stage juvenile RRP, it showed a report of two children, one which was a 12-year-old child who had was diagnosed with HPV 11 associated RRP in 2006, and multiple debridement was done. In a span of around 4 years, the child underwent 54 times obstructive event which required surgery, and from November 14 onwards, November 2014, this he was put on Avastin or bevacizumab treatment. Only 7, till for around 3 years they follow up the patient, and seven my only seven debridement was required for the child in a 20 month follow up, so which is a good outcome. And another another is of another child, like the second, it contains two reports, which was a success story of another child who had a like disease surgery free interval of like it was from first he was requiring surgery at a frequency of 8 weeks, then which decreased to 6 weeks, and approximately every month he required surgical intervention. But with the use of bevacizumab, significant improvement was seen, and only one like when this study came out in 2019 March, so till that day for around 4 months they followed, only one debridement was required for the patient, and here the dose was 10 mg per kg. So vaccines, among the vaccines, mumps vaccine was used intralesionally, and it was used as an experiment. No reproducible outcomes were noted by others. Only a single report was shown in a series of patients, 38 patients, which showed 76% of patients having remission, and this was achieved by an injection of 4 to 26, and within a follow-up, then was followed for around 2 to 5 years. Then comes the HPV therapeutic vaccine, HSPV7. This the development of therapeutic vaccine using E6 and E7 as the target antigen is the basic of this HSPV7. The heat shock protein E7 was derived from the Mycobacterium bovis, the Bacillus galactica urine, and combining it with the E7 protein of HPV16. The phase 2 study results over a 14 month period, which it showed the intersurgical interval doubled in almost half number of patients, and surgeries decreased significantly. It has got a systemic immune modulator with a low side effects profile, so this is an upcoming thing. Next is the photodynamic therapy. The rapidly proliferating tissues take up photosensitizing agent, so they release tumor cell oxygen derivatives when activated by a laser light. The examples are DHE, MTH, PC, and Foscan. These are some photodynamic agents, agents which were used for this therapy. 4.25 milligram per kilogram DHE is injected before photoactivation by an argon pump dye laser. The main disadvantage of photodynamic therapy is the photosensitivity, which lasts for around 2 to 8 weeks, leading to poor tolerability to the treatment. So homeopathic medicine Tuja Arborvitae is known to cure benign warty exercises and condylomas. It was conducted by names New Delhi. Our institute, we conducted a study on that. Sugar coated pills were given to patients, but the report was it was not found to be more beneficial or potent than the placebo which was given. And tracheostomy, it constitutes it really results in a iatrogenic squamous ciliary junction, additional predilection for which is an additional predilection for papilloma. Extensive tracheobronchial seeding of disease is documented, which is a result of tracheostomy. Sometimes, so it there will be some situations where it is a life-saving one, and which is unavoidable. So in authors have advised for an earlier decanulation. Here we can see a report by our own department. This published in the European Journal of Biomedical and Pharmaceutical Science by Dr. Prabhu and Dr. Kapil. In this X-ray is sufficient of child of the child, 6-year-old child who had a case of recurrent respiratory papillomatosis, and it came in stridor the emergency, and the X-ray showing the narrowing of the lumen and the posterior lesion, the posterior wall. This was the intraoperative image. there was complete obstruction of the lumen, and he and first and he was he underwent tracheostomy, and he was ventilated, so he was given anesthesia through that, and after completely debriding, whatever lesions could be debrided, and after coming to this picture, after ensuring a proper lumen, we have decannulated the patient on table surgically. So this is a report which was published of a 6-year-old child. Then the risk of malignant transformation. The HPV 6 and 11 are considered lower risk types, and they are not typically associated with malignancy, although transformation to recurrent respiratory transformation are described. The rate of malignant transformation is 1 to 2%, and it is reported in adults with other risk factors, especially who use tobacco or have radiation exposure, and also in children with prolonged and extensive disease and distal spread, especially tracheobronchial disease. They have gradual molecular transformation recurrent respiratory papilloma to the malignant counterpart. In one example, it involved the integration of HPV 11 DNA into the host genome in malignant tissue samples and mutation of p53 proto-oncogene. So in short, the practice guidelines, when a patient present with stridor, progressive stridor and persistent stridor, dysphonia and respiratory distress, detailed history has to be taken only in case of patients who are not in respiratory distress. Short history and examination, and if possible, flexible laryngoscopy has to be done, or if the patient is very uncooperative, we can go to take the patient to an operating room and do an endoscopy or laryngoscopy. And if respiratory papillomas are seen, then we can do rigid airway endoscopy or micro-laryngoscopy with CO2 laser ablation. Then we have to, and at the same time, we have to take the biopsy and send for HPV typing and find the, we can, this guideline from international book. So they are mentioning the death case staging has to be done and severity scoring has to be made. And at the same time, we have to go for an aggressive control of GR, which is thought to be a cause for inflammation. At the same time, we have to give a call to the speech therapy team, and we have to get in touch with the speech therapy team. And a repeat office examination has to be done. The patient has to be kept in a regular follow-up. Then patients who are with minimal airway symptoms, periodic rigid endoscopy with microlaryngoscopy, carbon dioxide laser are to be used. And using the staging and severity scoring, we can check whether the patient is coming into the three phase, either resolution or the persistent disease or progression of symptoms. In patients like with marked airway symptoms, frequent rigid endoscopy with microlaryngoscopy, carbon dioxide laser, staging and severity is done as it is used for the same. And we with if it is having the, if the child is or the adult is having minimal airway symptom, he or she will go to the other arm, and if there is resolution, is well and good. Otherwise, if it is continued marked airway symptom, then we have to intervene, then consider adjuvant therapy, interferon for photodynamic therapy, sidofovir, and resolution pediatric. If there is resolution, we have to keep the patients in follow-up. And if there is minimal airway symptom, we will follow as previous. So this is in short how we manage a patient. And what are new advancements in the recurrent respiratory papillomatosis? So as I told you earlier, PD-1, it's a T lymphocyte co-inhibitory receptor, and its ligand PD-L1. These are thought to be contribute to a locally immunosuppressed environment, which is providing a situation for the cells to causing immune system evasion and resultant papillomatosis growth. The increased rate of PD-1 T lymphocyte infiltration and PD-L1 expression on both papilloma and infiltrating immune cells are being seen, and targeting the PD-1 pathway. It gives us a promising strategy for treating recurrent respiratory papillomatosis. So there are drugs, PD-L1 antibody, anti-PD-L1 antibody, which is avelumab, and anti-PD-1 antibody, which is pembrolizumab. So the trials are going, You can see this one. This is an activated T cell. So the tumor cell, it presents the MHC, this is a T cell receptor. So this is a PD-1 receptor and this is a PD-L1. So if this gets activated, this will cause immune system evasion, and the cells immune system will get evaded, and so which results in a papillomatosis growth. So anti-PD-1 antibody or anti-PD-L1 antibody, this will be successful. These are thought to be successful. These are under trials in US under FDA review and all. The next is the DNA vaccine. DNA vaccines are under investigation for their greater potential therapeutic benefit. DNA vaccines contain the DNA blueprints to synthesize these proteins. These vaccines, like compared to the other, in other normal vaccine, we give the protein epitope, but in this we give the vaccine which is taken up into the cells, and it promotes a greater immune response because these get transcribed and these protein are all made, and like it results in a greater immune response than simply presenting those antigens. In addition, DNA vaccines can be linked to other proteins such as cal reticulin that may further enhance the immune response. Specific HPV 11 CD8 positive T cell response have been shown, and slow tumor growth has been demonstrated in animal models. This is an upcoming thing, DNA vaccine. So this is an article which this report in January 2020 in the vaccines. There is the immunotherapy targeting E6 and E7 oncogenes of human papilloma virus type 6. It reduces, eliminates the need of surgical intervention in the treatment. So in this study, they have recruited three patients. Out of it, two patients had, even though it was a phase one trial, they recruited two patients who had RRP. And out of the three children, they were all adult population. Out of these three, two were adult patients who had recurrent respiratory papillomatosis. So one patient demonstrated a greater than threefold increase. You can see in the image, greater than threefold increase in the avoidance of surgery. And the other patient, when the study got completed, till that after the giving the drug, this patient didn't have there's a fivefold increase in surgery interval, and the patient didn't require any surgery till the study was completed. So so they use the INO-3106, which is an immunotherapy agent, which resulted in induction of HPV-6 specific cellular response across a variety of immune assays, the confirmation of production of IFN gamma and using ELISpot, and confirmation of expression of activation markers such as granzymes, perforins, found in the was found, and this came, thus they concluded that this is causing a high multiplied response to the E6 and E7 oncogenes, causing the result of prolonged surgery free interval in the children, in the patients. This is an article which came in the Photodiagnosis and Photodynamic Therapy, and in this there are 8 patients underwent photodynamic therapy for the lesions, and 7 had response, 1 didn't respond, and the one patient who didn't respond was multiple debridement, and it's a medically and surgically non-responder previously also. Treatments do the duration of disease-free recurrence range from 4 to 33 months, and if 5 of the 8 patients had sustained ongoing treatment effect ranging from 10 to 33 months, and most patients had improved quality of life and a reduction of interventions. And in this study, they used the Fortrin agent, which was the photodynamic agent which was used. This is a paper which came in March 2020. So that's one for today. I'll be starting the WebEx meet, Cisco WebEx meet. Thank you.